Okay, so welcome everybody to this session about aligning your customers and product success in a SaaS world. My name is Evelien Schut. I'm working for GoGorilla, and I've been working as a Scrum Master for almost 4 years. But since a few months, I'm in a new position. I'm now a community consultant for Open Social. And the reason I'm having this new position is has everything to do with what I'm talking about today. So it will make more sense in the next slides, what I do and why I do it. So in 2016, GoGorilla has started to build their own product, a SaaS product. And that was basically the moment that we shifted from an agency to a more product-focused company. And this session is about how we had to change our approach in how we deal with our customers, how we service them. And because, as I said, I was a Scrum Master before. So I had to work with our customers on a daily basis. We worked in sprints, so we had a really extensive relationship with our customers. We talked about them, about feature wishes, and they helped us testing and stuff like that. So we really had a good, extensive relationship with them. But when you're selling SaaS, your ultimate goal is that you have a very large customer base, and you're actually servicing your customers with less contact moments, so actually, well, the least as you can get. Because also they are using the same product, so it's a standard product. There's nothing customized specific for this customer. So the way you have to deal with them is a totally different thing. So I will take you through some of the lessons we learned in the past few months, actually, and things we needed to change in our workflow and the way we talk to our clients. But first, let me give you a very brief introduction of the product, because Open Social, it's called, and it's a community platform, and it's a platform where people can collaborate, share knowledge, organize events, and it's really suitable for an intranet or for like a volunteer community. It can be even a really big one. We serve a lot of NGOs, but it can also be like your local soccer club, for instance. And the reason we built this product is because we had the most expertise in this area. And it's also really the next big thing. I think even Dries told it in his keynote. So we're really on track. And Open Social comes in a few flavors, actually three. So the first one is our distribution. So it's completely open sourced, can be downloaded. And as you can see by the numbers, it's really active. It's been downloaded quite some times. And we also maintain it on a daily basis. And we still are improving it and building new features for it. The second thing that we have, this is our SaaS product. So we call it our basic product, so it's the standard product you get for an amount that you pay per month. So 95 euros per month to 100 users. And you get some extra specific features on top of the distribution. And we also have other pricing plans when you exceed 100 users. And the third flavor is our enterprise flavor, because we also have customers who have very specific wishes and bigger wishes than the standard product. So we build it on top of the basic product. But this session is really about our SaaS product, so the software as a service part, because that is also our main focus. So in the beginning of this year, I think it was April, we launched the SaaS product, and we have now a fully automated version, which means you can go to our website at getopensocial.com. You can fill in some credentials. You grab some coffee, and in the meantime, your platform is being installed. I think it takes 15 minutes. It's hosted on platform.sh, and yeah, you can immediately start using it, invite users, create some content, whatever you want. So that's pretty cool, I guess, and it's also our first step into this big, big SaaS world. So far, so good, we thought. And yes, the technical part is in place, and it's really good, and we're really proud of that. But there were two main challenges we had to face. And the first challenge was conversion, because when you download our platform, you first get a 30-day free trial, because you can try it out, you can really get to know the platform and see this, if this is the perfect fit for you. And when you think, yes, this is what I need, you fill in your credit card details and you can start using it, and you will be charged every month for it. So signups were pretty good. We had about 30 signups for the trial version, but converting them into paying customers, that was really hard. And because we had automated everything, like the entire process, we were also not really in contact with them. So we had basically no clue why they didn't convert. The other challenge, that was how to retain our customers. So once they are actually on board, they are a paying customer, how do we retain them? And it's also a bit of a problem maybe within the product itself, because building communities, setting it up, inviting your users, that's one thing. But if you really want to have a healthy community that is supporting itself, users are very active, they're creating content, that's a totally different thing. I think it can take up to 12 months on average before it's really healthy. And it takes a lot of effort of community managers. So I think it can even be a full-time job in the larger communities. So that's really, really a challenge we have to face. So up till the beginning of this year, we had focused on technique, so the product and its features, automation, even the updates are automated, so with only one push of a button, we update all our SaaS instances. But we knew that now we had to shift our focus from the more technical point to the more customer-facing issues. I'm going to tell you four challenges, four tips, four things we changed. But before I do that, I want to make sure that that it's understood that customer success is not just one team that really focuses on it, at least in our company. I think it should be really a culture, because all these teams are working on a product, and they should be, they all should be involved in the customer success part. So if you look at the marketing team, they're already involved, even if the customer is actually a paying customer. Because it's really important that we have documentation, stuff in place that when they have to convince other stakeholders, that they can show something, and also in the buying process. And the product team is also really important in the research phase, because they need to be really transparent on their roadmap. Because, okay, maybe at this point a certain feature is not in there, but if you really be transparent about your roadmap, you can show when it's coming, or maybe it's not coming, then this is also something that that in their research is really important to know, of course. Yeah, so we are working with an entire company towards customer success, but the four things that I will show you now is really related to the things that I was involved, and I'm in the community team, so it's mainly about onboarding and retaining them. Let's see, the first one is about onboarding. And we have actually two ways we look at it, because first we have to get them on board. They have to become a paying customer out of this trial period. So, again, we set up this 30-day trial, but they didn't convert automatically. So we made a change in there. And what we do now is we actually put on our website that they can request a trial. So they leave their phone number and their email. And the first thing we do is we call them and we get to know them a bit. We ask especially what they are looking for in Open Social and what are their needs. And based on that, we set up a live demo. It takes about 30 minutes. We try to lower the barriers as much as we can. But on the other hand, customers need to be a bit dedicated to get to know us as a platform and as a company. So in 30 minutes, we show them around. We set up the platform a little bit in their look and feel so that they can relate to it. And if they're still interested, then they get their 30-day trial. And it's also a great way to already be in touch with your customer. You can address some early questions. But also for us, maybe at the end of the demo, they're like, okay, this is not really what we're looking for. I do not need this free trial. But it's also valuable to us because we know then and we can ask them, what are you missing? And it's really good feedback for us. When we changed this process, it was in August. Up till then, the sign-ups were pretty high, but it dropped. But we don't think that's really bad because we see these trials that are really dedicated and they are really a good match with our product. And yeah, they are like higher value in our opinion. So this is, it looks less like 10 a month, but if we can convert 6 of them every month, that's really awesome, of course. Yeah, the other way of onboarding is when they're really on board and they are this paying customer. You don't want to let them lose and think, okay, now everything will go by itself and we'll get them their money every month. No, we're still guiding them through the first phases of running their community, but we're also really checking how they use the platform. Do they use all the features in there? Are they neglecting certain parts? Or every time we do a new release, we send out release notes. But sometimes we learn that it's not really, that they not really read it. So we also check, okay, are they using these new features? Or do we need to show them around? So that's all like on one-on-one contact. But of course, we also need to provide a lot of documentation for the cases that they need quick answers. So that's also something that we're really dedicated on, and we work hard on that. I think this seems like a lot of effort. And we've also been thinking of automating this process, like in the tool itself, like building some kind of wizard that lead them step by step through the process. It's still something on our mind, but we took a step back and we're now really talking to them. So this is also a great way to learn what this wizard should do in the end, so that you're actually building the things they need. So second thing is that you have to position yourself as a thought leader, because it's not only that you're providing a tool for them. If you can also show that you're really into the business that they're looking for, that in our case, that you're really into community building, that you can help them engaging in their platform, make sure everybody's active, then it's most likely that they will choose for you instead of a tool that doesn't provide that. And how we do that is different ways. So first of all, we start blogging about it. And we also market this in different social channels, of course. And I think we blog a lot about it because you have to be out there and you have to reach them over and over again. So blogging. We also create some more extensive white papers where we give them more in-depth advice on how to run your community. And I think the third and most important thing is that we have set up a service where we consult them in building their communities. So really talk to them on a monthly basis. We help them set goals, monitor these goals, and also reach these goals. And in the end, our goal is, of course, that their community is paying off and that they renew their contract over and over and over every month. Third thing is that you have to listen to your customers because you get a lot of feedback from them. And sometimes it's feedback on features you already have but need improvement or new feature wishes that they have. You have to really gather and store this data because it's most important for us. And not only from customers but also the sales team who talks to leads, to these trials, to in other conversations. All this data needs to be stored. And we do that in a way, in a tool. It's called Receptive. And this is a nice way of showing that this is something we have automated because we started out in spreadsheets and in our head, but our customer base is growing, our leads are growing as well. So the spreadsheet is not enough anymore. And this is where we decided to choose for a tool, Receptive, as I said, which is really awesome. And I'm really, really big fan of it. Because customers can get their own account, can submit feature suggestions to us, and can also set their priorities, as you can see on the right, against each other. And then other nice thing is that if other customers submit feature suggestions, that they can vote on them as well. And the same as the product team adds some features in here, that they can vote on it, say, meh, I don't want this, or yeah, this is a nice feature, I want it, and this is my priority. And they can also see our roadmap in here, so that's a part of being transparent again. And then the other part is how we can handle this data. Because we can create all kinds of smart lists, as they call it here, with the top priorities. And we can look at all of our customers, we can look at our customers with a high value or with a low value, or leads. So this is really valuable input, and we use this on a daily basis, we check new suggestions, and we also use this in our roadmap meetings. So we really try to listen and build what our customers need. And that's a really big thing for us, and it's a really handy tool. Last thing is measure, because in the end you want to know if all this effort you're putting in there and talking to your customers and all these hours are really paying off. But this is also a whole other thing in the SaaS world, because you can measure like everything, but where do you start? What we do is we look at the maturity models that are out there. Maybe a bit too detailed, but I don't have enough time to explain everything about it, but it basically is a model which shows the different stages a company can go through, from a startup phase to a more emerging phase to scaling phase, where you have a really large customer base. And on the top, it shows on different pillars what kind of steps you can take if you are going through these phases. So in this case, it's the metrics, and this is also how we addressed it. So we said, okay, what did we do so far? We have calculated our monthly and annual recurring revenue. We have also counted our customers, which was pretty easy. We could do it with our two hands at the time. But then we said, okay, now it's growing. We need to know more. And on different aspects also. So on the top, you see the core success metrics. They tell you something about the amount of customers, of the percentage of customers you are able to retain or that are leaving you. And the growth in net revenue retention rate is about the revenue that you're able to retain every month or that you maybe expanded. And on top of that, we also need to know how our product is used. So we started out small because you can track everything there. But we built some analytics inside our SaaS instances where we can track their active users, the amount of content created, all kinds of things, so that we actually know that the platform is used or not. And I think last thing is really important, because we also measure the customer happiness. And because all the figures on top could look really good, people are not leaving you, platform is pretty active, but in the end, if 6 out of 10 customers is unhappy, your figures could look totally different next month, of course. So we also track the happiness of the customers. And you can do it really difficult. You can also start really simple, that the person who is in most contact with them, that they can rate the customer in the way they're happy. Can be really simple like that. But these three figures together says, well, a lot about your customer base. So our main lessons in this SaaS journey is, don't think you can automate everything from the start, but get in touch with your client, talk to them, take them by the hand, gather their feedback, and measure, see if you're doing okay, if you need to adapt. And I don't think like automating from the start is really bad, but it can just be tricky because you're not sure yet if you're automating the correct things. You're not sure how they're using your product at this point. So before I go to the questions, some formalities. Would really nice if you could join a code sprint on Friday. There's also a code sprint of Open Social. So if you want to check out our product or even help us out, fix some bugs, you're welcome. And our tagline is make your people bloom. Maybe you've seen them already, but at the door there is a small present, small sunflower. You can grow it and you can share your results on Twitter with us. Maybe you'll get a small prize if you have the largest one. So take him when you leave. Questions?
What's the average size of community?
As in users, you mean? It's not about the amount of users, I guess.
Active users.
It's about active users, but we also see it, it's called the community life cycle, because you start out and your community managers are running the place, they're the one who creating content. But in the end, what you want is that the rest of the users is taking over and start. So when that is happening, then you're talking about this healthy community. So, and that's to reach that, so that the community managers are just more like facilitating and not like fully a full-time job creating content and pulling people to the platform. That's the moment when you can speak of a healthy community.
And how many people do you have besides the community managers?
In the community? Yeah, we have a lot of different communities. So we have smaller ones, we have larger ones, and the larger ones have about 50,000 users. But we also serve communities that only have 30 users. So there's really not one answer to that.
Is that your biggest community, 50,000?
Yeah, in Open Social, yes. We started this project because we also have built a community for Greenwire, of Greenpeace. It's called Greenpeace Greenwire. And in there, we have 100,000 users. So that's something we want to reach with Open Social as well. So 50,000 is already pretty nice and proud. Yeah.
I might have missed something at the beginning, but in terms of like product or revenue, let's say, is it mostly from the product, and or is it from services around the product? Is there a mix between them?
That's a good question. We're also a bit. Yeah, a bit trying out still, because we also are like experimenting with our pricing model. But services could be really interested to extend your business indeed. And I think that's also something we're really focusing on now, especially because it's also pretty important in our product. But I think services could become even bigger indeed. The percentage, I think it's 50-50 at the moment.
Okay.
Yeah.
So 50% of the projects, they require customization?
Yeah. Because the product is still a bit in an early phase, so it can lack some features in cases. So that's why this enterprise flavor is there, and there's an entire dedicated team who works on building these enterprises. Yeah, that's also a good question, because that's our enterprises. The basis is the same. So if we add a new feature to the SaaS version, like private messaging maybe, then the enterprise customers will get it too, indeed. So that goes like without any extra costs. But sometimes we build like a very specific module that we don't want in the SaaS version. We don't put it in the SaaS version, but we do upsell it to other customers. So it will not be in the standard products, but yeah, we upsell it.
And you said that you only have two hands full of customers at the SaaS
version. In the beginning, yes.
And now?
And now it's doubled. So we need a tool, because we can't use our hands. No. So yeah, it's still in the early phase. We're now 5 months on the road, and It's a tough market, I guess, but we're still really dedicated to it, and yeah, we will make it work.
This is a little bit of a possibly technical question, but
I think maybe one of the tech guys can answer it. I'm not sure about the time and if there's somebody else behind me, like a next session. I think time is up. So thanks for attending, guys, and take your present.